Okay, so the first thing we always start, why do we need to write? So this is something you might have heard before, but I always emphasize on because that is basically one of the main drivers to make you strategically thinking about publication. So I just compile all possibilities where, regardless of your position as a student or as a researcher or as a research officer. So number one is to disseminate knowledge to prove original work. Also to secure knowledge, ownership claims, to obtain recognition for idea, to seek collaboration sometime to prove that you are a valid collaborator. So you have to show some capabilities in this particular case. So this is through publication, to acquire research fund, to apply for research fund. That so you have to prove that you have a prior record and the proof of concept of that particular research is already published and can be obviously seen. Also to seek expert service if you are, for example, a consultant or something. So well, you have to prove that you have the what do you call it, the potential to do that. So this is also through publication. To be invited for meetings, for talk, to give talks, to complete or conclude the project sometime. When we have projects, we have to, put some publication. So to get promoted, this is in case of lecturers or those who are seeking higher positions. This is all valid, actually, reasons that push individuals from different streams to acquire publication. But for students, it's basically number one, it's actually required for graduation. So it's a requirement. But in this particular case, are you meeting the minimum requirement or the outstanding performance in this case? So to get a postdoc, so basically if you are a PhD student and you want to get a postdoc, so the only chance is during PhD to make an interesting publication so that people won't acquire your CVs as a postdoc. So, and basically, the most valuable piece of research you may ever do in your life is your PhD. So, if you can't publish from that, it will be very hard to publish even later. You will lose the motivation in this particular case. Of course, also, you may be looking for a job, a lecturer or other jobs. Even though many jobs, they don't have a research requirement, but they will look at the publication as part of your eligibility for that particular job. So anyway, it can be any one of these or all of these. And of course, I'm sure there are other motivation, that you can find. So for every individual, look at yourself and try to get yourself motivated, get the target. Of course, we seek a target that is set by the university because it's beyond of our control. But of course, if you take it as a what do you call it, obligation, it's sometimes it's too hard and you feel basically it's a nightmare. So what to do about it? Basically, you need to have a passion for it because this is basically what people can see about your work. People do not know how many hours, how much work you have done during a PhD except what you have published. So I evaluate you from what you have written. People are interested to know what you have written. Right, so put this in front of you. Always keep yourself motivated. Do it by passion rather than by pushing. Okay, so basically, this research it starts based on particular idea or based on particular research question or based on a problem. So this particular research will lead to a data because the students are concerned very much with collecting the data. So data itself doesn't mean much. So data has to be analyzed. And when the data is analyzed, it is converted to information. And when the information is interpreted, it's converted to knowledge. So what we are trying to, disseminate here is basically a knowledge, not a data or not an information. You are not simply, for example, using the data to formulate some equation. You can formulate some equation, like for example, some of students they use response surface method to optimize the number of experiments or to optimize conditions and so far. Okay, the problem is at this level, when you make your quadratic equation, and you make those numbers, it doesn't mean much. It's information. There's nothing there. You're seeing there is a relationship there, but how to interpret that? That is what will be the knowledge. That is what you have to disseminate by the end of the day. And you know, this is very important to understand when you start to do research, especially for beginners. You know, collecting the data is basically one stage, and this particular stage has to be carefully carried out, especially when you use equipments where equipments are or must be calibrated or must be well maintained, so the data can be real. Because sometimes you have equipments giving you false signals, false data, data which is not correct, and you kill yourself trying to, you know, explain something which is basically does not exist in your material. So the types of publication, we have primary scientific publications. What does it mean here? It means these publications that come directly from your data, from your research, okay? So we have secondary scientific publication, which is basically come from secondary data. Secondary data means is data that has been published. What would be the case here is basically review articles. Review articles is basically using the other people's findings and sitting them, putting them together so that I can draw a new picture for this particular field or for this particular subject. At the end, in the second part, I have some slides on review articles, because that is one of the potential articles that many students actually should aim for, even though not all successful. But you should try. You wouldn't lose anything. You should try. You wouldn't lose anything. Okay. Then I have to review what's known as scientific journals. See, so scientific journals basically to report the progress in experimental or theoretical aspects. So it is not about, as I said, rehashed papers, recycling of research, and so on. So you have thousands of titles available, right? And journals are highly specialized and highly technical. Some of them are really highly technical, and I will show you some differences where one can actually attempt to, you know, to diversify the publication. Many, they don't know, including myself. When I was a student, I didn't know. I know only review, I know the article. But later, I discovered that there are other potential things that one can do, right? So these articles or these journals only read by the specialist, people who are technically understanding what is published in these journals. And of course, they are peer-reviewed. Peer-reviewed means it's not just because some, they think if I know the editor or if I have a friend there, even though some, they may argue there is a monopoly, okay? But a good journal will be very, very careful to publish something because that is not really proper. Because what? There is nowadays, you know, with the social media, with the, you know, people can write a letter to the editor, can write a commentary on your article, exposing what so far has been done. And I have a case where one, senior figure and a very famous author wrote, you know, to the editor of the journal, a commentary and accusing the certain particular group of contaminating the literature with rubbish. This, I'm using the terminology exactly, with rubbish data, fake data, stuff like this, you know, rehash data, all this terminology. Why they make this comment? He communicate with the authors, the corresponding author, asking him to explain how he make this particular calculation. When they couldn't answer, he made it public, and it is public in the journal, you know, as a commentary, you know. Can you imagine that? So this makes you should be very, very careful, you know, because everything can be seen now, you know. So those journals publish, you know, you have to know about this also, because this is a good information. For example, some journals are published twice a year. Some they publish four times a year. Some they publish every month, you know. Some journals, like, for example, Journal of Applied Polymer Science, every month they have issues. So it's so fast, you know. So it, you know, it's a lot of issues. So part of the information you know about journals, so you need to know, because if you are in hurry, you wouldn't publish in a journal that appear twice a year, because you need your article to come as soon as possible, right? So this information are important about specific journals you target. Okay. This slide also is interesting in a way. I tried myself to combine to show you some ideas here. First, if you look at the first column here, we are talking about different scholarly or peer-reviewed journals. If you look at it, some of them, you know, like covers one subject area, for example, like chemical engineering, or for example, catalysis or process control, right? So when you look at this, so these journals, it means they cover everything under the field of chemical engineering, okay? So or catalysis, for example. So some are very specialized. For example, like when you talk about intelligent information system, that's very specialized. But this is under computer research, okay? But you specialize in intelligent information system. For example, Journal of Infrared, multimeter, whatever waves. That is something very special, right? Especially inside the field. It means, for example, you can have a chemical engineering journal, and inside that one, you find a very special journal called Journal of Membrane Science, for example. That particular journal is specialized in membrane, for example. You have some other journals specialized in separation and purification, which can be membrane or any other chemical processes, for example. So that is how would I know that? I know from the scope of the journal. And most of the students, if not all, they never read of the scope of the journal. They never read the scope of the journal. They think they're all the same. How would I know that? For example, you submit one article to the journal. So you take the same article according to somebody's advice, and okay, it changed a little bit on the title and put it in another journal without looking at what are the special feature about each journal. For example, if you talk about chemical engineering science and you talk about Journal of Chemical Engineering, these two journals, Q1, but they are totally different. Of course, totally different in what? One published fundamental research, the science of the chemical engineering, the science behind that. Another one is application. You get what I mean? So here, when you go to chemical engineering science, you must be dealing with something fundamental, okay, that you are making a conclusion out of it. For example, some other journals, we call them multidisciplinary, and these particular journals start to appear now, especially with some publishers like American Chemical Society or Royal Chemical Society, realizing that they want to separate, journals which is number one in the field with high impact factor, with prestigious journal, from say they have like a repository. When they have a repository, they come out with something called ACS Omega. This Omega you submit to a normal chemical engineering journal, for example, or macromolecular journal in American Chemical Society. When they reject, they ask you to put it in this Omega. It's like a, I'm sorry, it's like a dump site. Sorry to say that, but it's not. But this one, because of it's a new journal, and this is their strategy to promote that particular new journal. And of course, you have to pay for this journal. So you get rejected from the main journal, then, okay, they try to, to give a compliment or just to be like nice to you, they recommend you this journal, okay? Right? There are some other journals like Scientific Reports. This is also multidisciplinary. Okay, this is also one of good journals, which is basically published multidisciplinary things. Okay, and very multidisciplinary. Multidisciplinary means it may come from biology, it may come from biomedical, it may come from chemical or electrical or electronic and all. Okay, then the process of peer reviewing. This peer reviewing is something very interesting. Why? Because, this peer review is basically trying to filter, trying to, find, in other words, find a mistake in your work. The idea is to make sure the accuracy, to make sure that the work is reproducible, to make sure that, the quality is maintained and what your claims are correct, because we claim things. This is to prove that the claims are, so it's a kind of audit, So this article goes through revision, and basically who are the peers? The peers are, researchers like you working in this particular area. Of course, they don't go for students, but they go for group heads or those who has published many articles in this particular field, professors and senior researchers and so on, right? So this is the process of peer reviewing. We call it the journal peer reviewed journals or refereed journals or jury journals. Those are the journals that go for peer reviewing process, and they have different types. They have also even some what you call it double blind means when the article is sent to the viewers, they remove your name. They remove the institution, so just the title and the text. They don't want to have, to make sure that there is no sympathy or there is no link, because you can choose your friend as a reviewer as well. And some misconduct in this particular case is happening, whether I want it or not, I cannot deny it. But this is not the best practice in any way. Look at this pictures and enjoy looking at that. So this is basically, this is your car when you send to the workshop. The workshop here is basically the editor of the journal who going to send to the peer review. So during the peer review process, this is what will happen to your car. Can you imagine? So if you look at this picture, it means they are going to look into everything. Of course, what I'm talking about here, somebody might argue, yeah, I have some paper, seen some paper, which is really, you know, published even with some mistakes there. Of course, the quality of reviewing process vary from one journal to another. Some journals, they want speed, they want time, fast. So, for example, I'm a professor. What I'm going to do, you know, not really, I'm busy. I will give it to my student, my PhD student, to make comment on that. And I add to the work, to make the matter worse, I never look at what my student has written. Then I submit. Can you imagine me doing this? Can you imagine yourself get evaluated by another student? So that is basically where some lapses and some not good quality publication or articles get through. But you know, some of the students did show me, ah, this one can get published. Mine also can get published. Who tell you that? How do you know? Every paper has own circumstances. And if it is published, people must have learned from that. So in this particular case, because that argument happened always, the student want to publish, the supervisor want to more work, more strength here, more discussion, and so on. So this is the circumstances where differences happen. But as I told you, if it is published, it is a past. You know. So now every year, there is a set of regulation trying to curb the malpractice in the field. And of course, as I'm telling you now, many people know that there is a misconduct. Some editors acting as a postman, just transfer from the reviewer to the author. And sometimes they are rivals, you know. So they can stop you in one way or another. Some, basically, they don't have good quality revision, basically. Yeah? Some, they're trying to show off, to show you like, oh, yeah, you know nothing. And I know more than you. Some of them even they ask for the, you know, the bird milk. They ask for a bird milk. You know, the bird doesn't have a milk. You have already enough data and enough, but still they want to more. So here, where to publish? I know we have index journal. You must know as a student, a PhD student or master student, you must know what's index journal. And we have the index database like ISI or they call it Web of Science or Scopus and so on. And also we must know what is the quartile ranking in index metrics. Like Q1, Q2, Q4, and Q1 and Q2, this is the target that most of the also the target is, and this is what is recognized by university as high impact publication. We have also non-index journal, and there are many of them. They are even they can contact you and try to seduce you to submit article there. When you submit the article, you just lose the article because you get nothing. Sometimes they ask you to pay money also, so we have to be careful. Okay. This is probably my last slide. Things to remember, you know, the way you have to weigh between bashing and pushing. You have to weigh between quality and quantity. You have to understand the differences between journals and keep in mind targeting Q1 and Q2 journal. With this, I come to the end. Thank you for your patience, and I hope I didn't make it so fast, or, you know, I tried to cover as much as I could. But you know, online is not really friendly in this particular case. I would have to interact with all of you face to face. Thank you very much.